Abbas Kiarostami taught me why we're all obsessed with heaven. Because all around us is paradise, we just can't appreciate it. Like someone in love. Like Yasujirō Ozu, one of his most important influences, Kiarostami showed the way modernity possessed people. The way it wanted to reach its claws into the earth and tear up any signs of historical continuity with our ancient self. Earthquakes and excavations keep his human characters apart. Kiarostami was fascinated by technology and frequently used cars and cell phones as devices to trap people into communicating. A personal aside, the reason so many of my films have lengthy driving scenes is because I loved the way that Kiarostami shot people in cars. Jump into things like someone. He saw the modernization of Iran as a mixed blessing. Simplicity is what his characters all chase, consciously or not, but they tie this concept too closely with a fictionalized ideal history or an unclear future. Unable to make their lives work on terms dictated by an unknowable government, they attempt to find a parallel existence. His international acclaim begins with Close Up, one of the finest documentary hybrids ever made. A kind of metafiction, it tells the story of a man who pretended to be a famous film director in Iran and was arrested and tried for his imposture. In one of many transcendent moments in the Iranian master's career, the scared mimic is rewarded after his long and arduous trial with a union with the man he'd been impersonating. Cinema steps into his life and holds him, as if they were old friends. This was the kind of magic that Kiarostami frequently pulled off. In his 2008 film, Shirin, A Gift to Critics and Theoreticians, he filmed dozens of faces of women watching a fictitious movie to show us the true glory of cinema, to show it performing its trick on these faces, which stand in for our own. The simplest idea, almost childlike in its affection for the female visage, performed with the utmost respect, wisdom, and dignity. His camera cares for their faces. Their intelligence and openness is his, and hopefully ours. He always hoped for the best from his audience. He trusted in us. In E Guilass, a man drives around the Iranian hinterland trying to find someone who will help him kill himself. He has already dug the grave, he just needs someone to bury him when he's inside. He cannot see the beauty of life anymore, evinced by the boundless, gorgeous landscape he drives through, but to which he is blind. For most of the film, the man is merely framed as if imprisoned by the door of his automobile, while outside industrial machines chew up the landscape, which appears to be presided over by soldiers. He could already be in the next world. And the wind will carry us. A man enters a provincial town on some vague errand he won't quite confess to the locals, from whom he begs accommodation. The phone calls he keeps receiving require him to drive into the hills for better reception. He seems to want to escape the world represented by the voice on the other end of the phone. He can't communicate with the world around him anymore, and so Kiarostami frequently frames him to accentuate his isolation. He appears to be talking only to himself.
صدای به این قشنگی رو میگم چرا قطع کردی؟ بخون یه مقداری برامون.
Like so many Ozu characters and later Kiarostami heroes, he stares directly into the camera. But unlike in Ozu, the screen is a sort of mirror, a way to distance himself from the people around him and continue his antisocial removal while he busies himself with monotonous earthly routine. In Certified Copy, a man and a woman are haunted by the ghost of a relationship which may or may not be their own. They perform a copy of a marriage, its highs and lows, with great intensity and passionate purpose.
Non, la patronne de café, elle disait que ce qui compte dans la vie, c'est d'avoir un mari. Bon ou mauvais, il fait l'affaire, mais toi, en tant que mauvais mari, tu pourrais être là de temps en temps.
No way. It's not really fair of you to give me this role of absent parent. Besides, there are about to be certain times when one parent or the other has to be away for whatever reason. You can't blame me for that now, can you?
Of course not, but you said certain times. And in your case, it's constant. When have you been here? When, mon chéri?
You're saying I've never been there.
Ah, c'est ici.
Here again, Kiarostami plays with mirror images, with the audience acting as a mirror for stars Juliette Binoche and William Schimmel, making us understand how identity and reflection can become fluid. They double each other by becoming a phantom version of themselves, just as the man pretended to be the doppelganger of a director in close-up. Man has infinite variations. Our world is a mirror of our vision of the next life. We could almost reach out and touch it. Kiarostami's fixation on travel reached its apotheosis with 2002's Ten, and one of the earliest and most successful experiments with digital film. A woman drives around her town as a kind of chauffeur for hire in this film. She ferries relatives, strangers, and friends around, ending with the most tender moment in modern Iranian cinema. The driver gives her passenger permission and a safe space in which to remove her hijab for a moment.
She just came to the shop.
In Ten, Kiarostami shows the beauty of so many things in this one gesture. The female passenger with her gorgeous shaved head, the camaraderie between these two women, the hope granted by art, the possibility that Iran could be better. That it could change. Gestures like this, found all over his filmography, transport the viewer and the Iranian people to a plane of safety and serenity, even if only for a moment. All could be graceful. All could be full of love. He never blamed us for how far we've fallen of our ideal. He knew that this life could be a paradise, and his films take us there.
Lately, I seem to walk as though I had wings, bump into things like someone in love. Each time like some